So hello everybody and welcome to another Tuesday Teaching Tips with me, Sally Cathcart. And welcome to today, where I'm going to be just going through very quickly my 5-point approach to teaching notation. Now, I was asked last week to give a talk to some local piano teachers online, and it was all about sight reading, so really, really interesting. But I had this lovely question at the end asked by one of the teachers who said, what do you think the best approach to teaching notation is? Do you think it's using, you know, letter names, or do you think it's using intervallic approach? And I thought that was such a good question that it kind of made me think a little bit about it all, and hence what I'm doing today, sharing what I think my 5-point approach is. So the first thing I do when I'm teaching notation is I first of all start by getting them ready to read notation. And that can happen for quite a long time, this getting ready, this preparation. And it certainly consists of singing, and it consists of playing. And it can include reading, but the reading can be graphic reading, reading a graphic score. It might just be reading an ascending pattern or a descending shape or something like that. It might be reading what I call rhythm solfège. Whatever it is, it's about the preparation towards stave notation. It's not stave notation itself, but it's getting the pupil with the music, the sound of the music in their head, literally, and the feel of the music in their hand and in their arm and, of course, in their fingers. And that can take quite a long time. Before I come to the second point, which is the introduction of landmark notes. Now, I've got a young student that I started back in April time. She's only had lessons online. We've done lots of singing. We've done lots of work for my Ready to Play with all the different songs and stuff there. She's reading in rhythm solfège. She's playing quite a bit as well. And we're just moving on to now landmark notes. Now, if you're not sure what a landmark note is, then a landmark note is, for example, notes that are easily recognisable. They stand out. They are significant and important notes. Treble G, middle C, bass F, yeah? Treble C. These are all landmark notes. And what I'll do often to help my students is I'll use some little props. So here, I'll just show you. I think if I bring it close enough, you'll be able to see that that is Big Ben. And point that out as being a landmark. I'll say, what's that? And then I've got the Eiffel Tower. Here we go. Yeah. And they can, of course, easily tell me that these are Big Ben and the Eiffel Tower. I'll say, those are landmarks. In other words, you don't have to think about it. It's a bit of a no-brainer. You can just tell me instantly what they are. And that's what you need to be able to do when you're reading these notes. So here, for example, is one of the landmark notes I might introduce them to early on. Bass C. Notice I give it a specific name, not just any old C, bass C. And of course, it's that one on the piano. Or I might give them, this would be another one that would come up in time, middle C. And treble G. Can you see that? There we go. And I couldn't find bass F, but bass F is obviously down here. So those are the landmark notes. And we spend a long time starting with pieces that have landmark notes absolutely at their core. What's important though is that you don't always have a piece that uses treble G as a starting note and you always put finger one on it, or you always put finger five. No, you use a whole range of fingers to start on that one note. So it might be finger five, might be finger four, might be finger three, might be finger two, might be finger one, because that's going to avoid them getting stuck in that one position and thinking, oh, that's just a finger five. Yeah, that can happen, can't it? Not when you do it in this way. So that's your second point. The third point is to then get them working and reading intervallically. So you can see how this is going back to the conversation that we had last week about intervallic reading. Intervallic reading in seconds or thirds, or should they go on fourths and fifths, reading by steps or by skips. Doesn't matter how you talk about it, as long as you're consistent in your talking, that is another important stage. Now here, I'm wanting them to read the landmark note and then read the shape, not try and work out what the names of the notes are. So let me just find one. Here we go. Here is bass C. Yep, so I'm wanting them to recognise that as base C, and then I want them to play the shape that they see, not work out that's D and that's E. We might go over that, but they don't need to know that in order to play that shape. And here's another one. Yes, okay, so here we have now base C. There we go. And this time, though, look, we're going up a third. So I would there expect them to be able to play that moving up a third. And again, once they've established the landmark note, they read the shape and the pattern that they see. So let's see, again, we've had preparation as the first point. Then we've had doing landmark notes as the second point. And then the third point has been all about reading the patterns from that. But of course, you're all saying, Sally, they need to know the names of the notes. Well, they will learn the names of the notes. You will continue to reinforce them. And that's one of the skills of, as you get a more experienced teacher, you know that you've got to keep reinforcing them, because this doesn't happen quickly. This is a long process. I reckon 3 years on average for children to really take ownership of their reading, which is pretty much comparable to what goes on with reading in school, if you think about it. They don't learn to read just in reception or in their first year. Where, you know, the reading process is staggered over a period of years, so that by the time they get to age 8 or 9, we are expecting them to be more fluent. So notation reading is just as complex, I think, and don't expect it to happen too quickly. Our job is to keep returning to it. So this is what the next point is about, which is where they learn the individual note names. Now, the more fun you can make this, the more they will take them on board and remember them. So what I use is, I have a particular app. Of course, these days we're so blessed because we have apps that we can use, and we can send them home a lot more fun than just little flashcards. So I love Flashnote Derby, my students love Flashnote Derby, and particularly this time of year, it goes reindeer racing, and they get so excited about reindeer racing, and they don't really realise that they're learning, which is of course always the best thing to do. So we're just about to have a Christmas challenge. We're just starting it this week. They're going to set a score, and each week they're going to come back and see if they can set a higher score, and by the end of it we have to add up 4 weeks of scores and see what score they've managed to do. So that is a wonderful way of getting them reading and recognizing those individual note names, actually, as an additional activity. But note that it is already number 4. It's the fourth point. And I only do it occasionally. I don't do it all the time. This isn't an ongoing thing. Let's keep it fun. Let's keep it short. Let's keep it really purposeful. So on to the fifth thing. And the fifth thing is, I think, one of the hardest ones for us all to do, and include myself in that, and that is writing it down. So let's encourage them to compose their own music. Using the language, using the notes that they know, can they write a piece of music starting on treble G that's got 2 bars and has got 8 crotchets in it, or 8 quarter notes? Yeah, and is it going to move by step, or is it going to move by skip? And the more confinement, the more limits you give them, the easier they'll find that. But it's that writing process that really unlocks the understanding for them. It really does, and it really helps to consolidate. And just going back to the way that they read in school, that's exactly the process that we follow there. We start by exposing them to sound, by getting them used to words. They use words fluently in conversation. We then begin to show them how that is constructed on a page, and they begin to put together sentences eventually, reading often patterns, guessing bits, that's really important, guessing. And then once they can read themselves, they also start to be able to write it, and it's that writing again that takes their understanding further forward. So let's just check those through. Preparation, yay, really important. We went into, yes, landmark notes, and then reading by intervals. Then we look at individual note reading and how to make that fun and purposeful. And then finally, writing it down. So this takes time, as I said. It takes up, I think, average 3 years to get really confident notation readers. And it's up to us as the teachers to continue to work with our students through that time. I've learnt from my own experience, no good just doing something once. I have to return. And I have a favourite saying, which I'm going to leave you with, and that is be persistent and consistent with what you do. Persistent and consistent. Do it over and over again, and don't change the way you do it. If it's working, don't change. Don't just go, oh, they haven't got it, I'll change. Stick with it for a few weeks before you then assess whether or not it's had an impact. So, some basic ideas behind introducing notation. Take your time, have fun. It's a long haul, but it's worth it when you get them reading really fluently. All right, happy teaching. Bye-bye.